taking up my cross every day, 'cause I live for you. Now I open up my mind, Jesus, anew the way I think, a kingdom state of mind. This is the way. I don't need a reason to praise you. This is my state of mind, my God. And come have your way in me. Let my heart never grow hard. Help me to keep it open as I lift my voice and sing. Hearing your presence, I'm undone. Have my life an offering, oh, for your glory. I don't need a reason to praise you. This is my state of mind, my God. In every season I'll praise you. This is my state of mind.
Well, welcome back everybody to session 3. Come on, I just encourage you to stand to your feet. We're going to start this session by praising God, declaring His love, declaring His glory. So come on, who's ready to praise in this place now? Come on, we're going to give Him all we got in this moment. Put your hands together. As we sing, Your love.
Your love in me has set me on fire. This joy I feel brings me to life.
Let songs of praise,
let songs of praise fall off my lips. These songs replay again and again.
Come on, we sing, we're holding on.
Oh, and I'm holding on to all. Hope that I found. Once alone,
You're here with me now. We declare, I won't give you up.
I won't give you up. You're all I need. So my praise goes up. I give you everything. I won't give you up. You're all I need.
So my praise.
All my praise goes up. I give you everything.
Come on, shout it out this morning. We're holding on. Hey!
Cause I'm holding on
to your love.
To all your love. My praise goes on. And I will never let you go. I'm holding on to all.
Give God a great shout of praise before you take your seat for a moment. Thank you, Lord. Woo! Amen. Well, you can grab a seat for a moment. Say hello to your neighbor. Welcome them back to session 3. What an amazing start we've had to this morning. It's an amazing open atmosphere over this place. How many of you know when the Holy Spirit is here and we're open, anything can happen? Anything can happen. And God is moving, amen? Fantastic. How many of you enjoyed hearing Pastor Leif Hetland? Give me a wave. Wonderful, wonderful. And we got a whole bunch more to go. Well, look, before we go into our next message kind of section, if you like, we wanted to take a moment to talk to you about Equippers College. Equippers College. And many of you will know we've had a training college in Auckland, New Zealand for I think nearly 30 years. That college has been in existence, and many people have been trained by that college, through that college. And some of you here are in this room as a result of being part of that. Around about nearly 3 years ago now, we felt like the time was right to launch Equippers College here in the UK. And just about a month ago, we graduated our second year of college students. And yeah, give them a hand for all the college students. Really, the idea of Equippers College is about giving God a year of your life to be trained and equipped for the rest of your life. And you know, I know there's such a huge emphasis on education and training in our world, and I'm all up for that and all up for looking after our education. But the thing that we will carry with us forever is our relationship with God. And the idea of giving God a year where you get the foundations of your faith in right shape and right function just sets us up for the rest of our lives. And so we got a little video just to show you some highlights of college of the last year. So take a moment, turn your attention to the screen. Let's have a look at this.
Hi, my name is Himansu. I'm from Equippers Kolkata, India.
Hi, my name is Jade, and I'm doing the second year at Equippers College.
Hi, my name is Ruben, and I'm from Slovakia, and this year I've been a part of Equippers College. And let me tell you what a life-changing experience that was.
In March 2022, they announced that Equippers College was coming to the UK, and something within me just leapt, and I was just so excited.
The college has aided and equipped me to build my abilities, self-assurance, and understanding of how effectively ministry is carried out.
It was a step of obedience, and I'm so thankful I did, because I found such amazing leadership skills from the learnings and the teachings, and how I can lead team and how I can lead myself.
My thinking, my vision got expanded so much. Instead of thinking of life as something to survive in, I started thinking of life of something to grow in.
God took me on such a journey of breakthrough and finding freedom. He was removing the lies that I believed over myself. He put a firm foundation, and my roots really grew deep within his word.
Giving a year to God, I have discovered the purpose of my life, in which I will serve Jesus and establish churches for the advancement of his kingdom.
It's been a year where I learned to rely on God, and it hasn't always been easy. There has been hardships. It required surrender, but that made the move of God in my life even stronger.
Comparing myself to who I was when I first came back to the UK and when I first started college to who I am now is just so different, and I've got such a joy within me.
Being in a creative team, I've learned so many skills that I can take to India.
I am ready to change the next generation for Jesus in Slovakia.
I now know I can be launched into whatever season is coming, what the next season for me, and whatever environment I'm going to work in, wherever I'm going to be, that I'm going to be fully equipped and empowered to go for it.
If you're planning to do a college this year and you are unsure, if you don't know the purpose of your life, I encourage you to give a year to God.
If I sum it up, it has been a year of an amazing opportunities and being equipped for life for Jesus. I want to thank God for this year and the Equippers College. Thank you.
There we go. Doesn't that look good? And so, you know, Equippers College here in the UK is not our only training organization. We have different places that you can train in Europe. But today we're just taking a moment to let you know about our UK college. Tomorrow you might be like, well, I'd love to know more about college. What do I do? To let you know, tomorrow we have something called the College Experience. Everyone say College Experience. That was very weak. Everyone say College Experience. And you are all invited to come and be part of College Experience just to find out more. It would be really helpful to us if you could scan the QR code that's going to come back on the screen in just a moment and let us know you're coming. And come and be part of that, where you can have your questions answered. You can meet some of the staff, meet some of the teachers. We're so blessed to have Pastor Steve Graham heading up our college here in the UK. Yeah, give it up for Steve. And So you can come and meet him. You can meet students who have already registered for next year. You can meet some students from previous years. And we invite you to come and explore the possibility of what it might look like to give God a year, invest in your future. Does that sound good? Amen. Well, look, it is my privilege today to introduce our next speaker, Pastor Danny Guglielmucci. How many of you have never heard Pastor Danny preach? Give me a wave. You've never heard Danny. You are in for a treat today. Danny is no stranger to our church family around the world. He has been journeying with us for many, many years, and he might say a little bit more about it, but 30 years ago, he pioneered an amazing church called Edge Church. Has four locations, three in Australia, one here in the UK. And just in this last little while, that church has been on the journey to become part of our Equippers family. And so in September, that church will be officially, as Danny says, we're getting married. And that's we're engaged right now, but we're getting married in September. And so our family is growing around the world. Danny is just an amazing, amazing man with an incredible heart. You are going to absolutely love what he brings today. I want you to stand to your feet. Give Pastor Danny just a huge hand as he comes to preach to us today. Come on, Danny.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Please be seated. What a joy. What a joy to be with family. And people you just meet 2 days ago, Dr. Leif, and he's like my brother, a family, and you don't find that anywhere else. And I'm so grateful to stand here today. 6 years ago, I was only given a few months to live. The doctors spoke to my wife and I and talked to us about life support. And I remember just in the hospital room, just tearing up. My wife said to me, her name is Sharon, and by the way, my name is Alfredo Daniele Guglielmucci. It's not Guglielmucci, but none of the English-speaking countries can say Guglielmucci. And the doctors were sharing bad news with us, and within a few moments, the tears started to run down my face, and my wife said, "How do you feel?" I said, "Sharon, I can't describe the peace I'm feeling right now." But then, having been in church life most of my life, I went to church 9 months before I was born, so I've been around in church for a long time. We talk about the presence of God. And boy, have I felt it last night, and what a great message last night, this morning. I've been sitting here thinking, when I was growing up in my Christian walk, we never had teaching like this. We need to be grateful for the revelation that God brings to us. And I've been around what we call the presence of God, and I believe you can feel the presence of God. And many times, at the age of 11, I had my first encounter with Jesus, and I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. But what I felt in that hospital room was that there was no music, there was no singing, but I knew that Jesus was present. You know, that inner knowing that in the darkest of days and the darkest of news, His peace can be ours. He can be present. But as a pastor, you subconsciously think that your purpose is a pulpit. But you know, I realized in that hospital room over the next few weeks, as I prayed with doctors, prayed with leaders that would come in from the hospital and talk about the things of God, that you don't need a pulpit to have a platform. And every one of us in this room is called by God, whether we stand behind a pulpit or not, to have a platform to represent Him. In 2015, a prophetic man from America called Rick Shelton was in my home. He was staying with us. His wife and my wife and I were sharing our home, and At 11 o'clock at night, I was in the back room. He came out and he said, I have a prophecy. He said, 3 days from now, that's pretty accurate, you know, clear, your phone is going to start ringing and young men and women from around the world are going to ask you to father them. And I thought, 3 days from now, exactly 3 days, the phone started ringing from different parts around the world. People had listened to some of our story of just our church and leadership. See, many years earlier, God had put something in my heart for fathering broken people and hurting people and young leaders that needed mentoring. And he said, 3 days from now, December 2015, he said, young people are going to ring. And the phone began, and it's still going today on many, many, many repeated times around the world, here in the UK. But January 22nd, 2016, my eldest son, who was also mentoring, looking after a youth group, loving those young people, and he was at a youth camp, and he was killed by a lightning strike on Friday. It was Friday the 22nd of January. How do you get a prophecy that says you're going to father many, many, many young people, and then you lose your own son 1 month later? You would want to give up. Say, God, where are you? But God has a way, even in the darkest of times, to just give you something that you know in the midst of your pain, he is there with you. And the day our son passed away, he was supposed to preach that night. Prepared his message that morning and left the outline on the front of his car, on the front seat of his passenger seat of his car. When we read the notes, it said, it's dark out there. There are storms. What are you going to do? What is your God perspective? And finishes his message outline, keep your eyes on eternity. I have a copy of it here on my iPad, of that sermon outline. He died 2:30 that afternoon. 1 week before he passed, God supernaturally allowed us to spend some time together, because normally we wouldn't have that time period together. We were driving in the car together and he said to me, Dad, I love you. I said, I love you too, son. And we shared how we felt about each other, not knowing that was the last conversation I would have with my son. Your life can break in so many ways when you think, God, where are you? But one of the things that I did in the good times, see, we've got to prepare in the good times what can carry us in the difficult times. I made a decision that I would not live my life by reason, that I would live my life by revelation. So when you have the I don't knows of life, you need to know what you do know to be able to hang on to. During that journey, God took me to Ezekiel chapter 37, where God speaks to Ezekiel, and many of us know the story, and he said, son of man, can these bones live again? I'm glad he wasn't hyper faith and go, yes, they can live again. Yes, they can live again. Just claim it. Just pray. No. He said, I don't know. Do you know Christians are not good at living in the I don't know? But you know, God. See, the world out there today lives in the I don't know. What a confusion sitting in chair number 3. But I'm so grateful today that in my I don't knows, I have my non-negotiable I do knows. I knew that I found him at the age of 11. I knew that he called me in my late teens. I knew while driving down a road and looking at a building that wasn't for sale, and Revelation says, that's your building. And a journey began of supernatural events that today it's just history. And you think, how does that happen? And that's because when we stay in chair number one, revelation flows. When you sit in chair number two, reason rules your life. And I made a decision all those years ago, God, I want to live a life of revelation. I want to hear from you. Can I stop here this morning and say, equippers, shout, all the churches related, God is raising up a movement, and I'm saying this with sincerity and humility, that is bringing about a new wineskin. And I want to tell you, it's not about empire building. It's not about abominations, I mean denominations. It's not about who's who in the zoo, who's important, who's not important. But it's restoring, listen to me, the hospitality of heaven back to the planet. I was preaching in Melbourne and I was at an event just visiting where a man by the name of N.T. Wright was speaking, and some of you know he's a very powerful theologian. People were wondering what he was going to speak on. And he got up and he said, you know, you may not understand all my books, and apparently he does his daily devotions in original Greek. I know a little Greek. He's got a fish shop around the corner from my house. It's about as much Greek as I know. And he says, today I want to speak to you about one word that describes the gospel of Jesus, and it's hospitality. He said, it's the welcome of the Father that says, come home to Daddy. Dr. Leif, thank you for showing us that today. Thank you for showing us what it means to be baptized in His love. You gave us yourself today. You gave us yourself today. I've had to learn that the hard way. I was raised in an Italian family. After the Second World War, my parents moved from southern Italy to South America. They went to a place called Montevideo, Uruguay, and I was born there. So I wasn't born in Italy, although I was raised by Italian parents. And at the age of four, we migrated to Australia, where my dad was involved in church planting, but in the Italian community. Now, all the time in South America, we spoke Spanish. We migrate to Australia, and everybody speaks now Italian with all the family, and I don't know what they're talking about. They take me to school, and they speak English. That's even worse. I don't know what they're talking about. I kicked the teacher so hard and wet my pants that they kept me out of school for another year. I was so full of fear. I know what it's like to be in a place where you don't know where you fit. Back in the 60s, the Italians were seen as weird people. I mean, the Australians would send their kids to school with sandwiches where the crust was cut off, with what we call Vegemite, you call Marmite. And that was their lunch. My mother would cut half a loaf of bread, pull the inside out, shove it with everything she could find, and then garnished with garlic. So you'd go to school and they could smell you coming. It's a great way to lose weight. Eat lots of garlic, you'll look skinny from a distance. And we were made fun of at school. We were made fun of and laughed at because we were the weird, they used to call us the wogs. Well, I am a wog today, I'm a warrior of God. But back then, it wasn't a nice name. And I just didn't fit anywhere. And I grew up in a culture, and for some of you from Italy today and even Europe and most of our cultures, our parents didn't know any better. They left a country of poverty at the time. They're trying to find a new life. They knew how to provide for us. They worked very hard to provide for us and to clothe you. And I'm an only child. I'm Italian. I'm an only child. My wife is Australian. She's one of 10, so I don't know what happened. And as an only child, my mother was overprotective. She would buy me clothes that were three sizes too big because she said I'd grow into them. And I was embarrassed. I looked different at school. I grew up in the era of the Beatles. Everybody had long hair. I would just love to have hair now, but back then, everybody had long hair. My father was a traditional, old school, legalistic Christian. So I used to cut my hair real short, and I was the only one at school because we're supposed to be Christians. And I'd go to school, and I did not fit in anywhere. Nobody saw that I'd cry myself to sleep and realized that while I was provided for, no fault of theirs, it never happened to them either, I never understood nurture. I never understood nurture. And so in my brokenness, I did the first 13, 15 years of my life in chair two. I mean, that was a great teaching. I'd never heard that before, but it just makes sense of everything that I know. Isn't it great that God can put language to some of the journeys we go on? And so I was very, very insecure. I was never told I could do anything well. So when the call of God came, I was working in a menswear store, just selling clothes. And bit by bit, as I was involved in my local church, let me say, friends, don't ever chase a position. Just chase God. And He will position you wherever He wants. The will of God comes looking for us. We don't have to chase it, we chase Him. And a call of God came that I felt, not me. No, I can't understand this. I'm not good enough. Italian. My wife married me because she was convinced I'd never be a preacher. She thought English was my second language, which it sort of was because I spoke Italian at home because that's all my parents wanted me to speak. My dad's still alive. He's been in Australia 66 years and he still talk like that, you know. Hi, you Turai. You can hardly understand him because they stayed within their culture that they migrated to Australia as entire towns. And they stayed. They are living the culture today of 1950, not realizing Italy's moved on. You know, we can do that in church life too. We become so isolated. I prophesy again right now that Equippers World and Shout and all the churches represented in this room, we cannot become insular. We can't become centripetal. That's a word they use as a step to depression. Do you know there are many depressed churches? Many depressed churches because they are inward looking. But I'm grateful that we can be a people that look out and see God bring transformation to the most broken. Been married 50 years next month. Thank you. Before we were married, I spoke and she listened. After 12 months, she spoke and I listened. 50 years later, we both speak and the neighbors listen. So, but we're still together. I said for our 50th anniversary, I'm taking her to Italy. Everybody clapped. I said, for our 55th, I'm going to go and get her back. They didn't like that. The reality is I'm the speaker in our marriage and she just listens. She hasn't spoken to me for 3 years. She didn't want to interrupt me, but, you know, 50 years of lots of undoing and moving from chair number two to chair number one. Two cultures that came together that did not understand each other. We used to fight. Well, I used to fight. She just listened. She'd wait for me to finish and she would say, "You finished now?" And that would make me even more angry. So to think that I'm standing here today is a miracle. But we are all miracles in God's making. If we learn to posture ourselves in that place of chair number one, I'm so grateful. I was going to preach this message, although it hasn't come out like I prepared, but as if it ever does. And then I walked in this morning and I heard that I was going to do it tomorrow, but I've thought, no, that's just going to flow on with what God. It's not about complimenting each other, it's about amening what God is saying. And God is speaking in this place. There is a move of God coming to, it's already begun in Europe. And I believe God is using the humility. Do you know, without humility, God can't do anything. The Bible says God resists the proud. Do you know, if I'm resisting you, that means you're coming towards me. I can't resist something that's going the other way. And all over the Western world, God has used people, but pride has gotten in the way. And God has to resist because he says, "I only have grace for the humble." So where there's pride, there's no grace. And I believe God all over the world right now is stirring his church, but there are seasons where he puts his hand on nations and on parts of the world. And I've been feeling for a long time that God is about to do something in Europe that's going to shake the rest of the world and go, "What is happening here?" But we've got to be people that don't live out of legalistic religious patterns, but are people that stay in chair number one and live out of revelation. I have had some amazing times. I've lived my entire life by revelation. The very day that a pastor walked into the menswear store and said to me, "God's called you and you know it and you're going to be our youth pastor, and we know you need to pray about it, but we believe this is God's will and you know it in your heart." I was so scared. I was happy scared. I was happy, but I was scared. And I've told many of the people here in the UK that I got on the bus the evening that I was given that word and I was on my way home. And on the bus, they gave you a ticket. And on the back of the bus ticket, it said, "Whatever's around the corner, God's already there." And God began to give me scriptures, and so I never came into serving Jesus as a good idea. It was initiated by him. It was a God idea. And so from the day I had that revelation to then pastoring a church when I didn't know what to do, we started a church with 25 people, and within the first 3 months it grew to 500, and I didn't know what was going on. And I thought it was revival, but it was actually reshuffle, people coming from other churches. And the way you leave is the way you cleave. And they brought their problems with them, and most of them brought chair number two. And it nearly killed me, and I didn't know what to do. But because of revelation from God's word, I was able to endure a journey that had miracle after miracle after miracle that only God could do. But in the midst of that, one of my sons breaks so severely. Many of you know Michael, our son, who broke through addiction. He broke through deception. One of the greatest youth speakers in the world, and he was writing some of the most amazing songs. He wrote the song Healer that many of you are aware of. And yet in the midst of that, he was living two lives. He loved Jesus, but his brokenness, because he was too afraid to share how broken he was. I'm glad we're coming to a new era where God's raising a church in Europe that's open for the broken. It's open for the broken. I thank God for ministries like we've heard today from Dr. Leif, because it's the love of God that leads to repentance. But at the time, our lives were shattered. I know God called me. I knew He planted our church. I'd always had a yes in my heart to whatever God wanted. Why does this happen to our family? And I don't want to be rude, please, but the nastiest people to us were Christians. The people that were nicer to us was non-Christian. They understood people break. They understood brokenness, where Christians had every opinion. And we felt so rejected, but in that, you so are tempted to jump into chair number two, and you start living out of your brokenness and reacting out of your brokenness. But I want to tell you today that God's faithful, and if we keep coming back to Him and get back into that chair number one and bathe under His love. And I remember one day I was reading 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and Paul is saying, like a mother, I gathered you. But three verses later, like a father, or four verses later, I urged you. And the Lord spoke to my heart. He said, you need the nurture and the nudge. We need the parenting anointing back in the family. And we need it back in our world. Today, people have all kinds of issues with their identity and all kinds of things. But part of it is the parenting anointing's gone out of our planet. So people either have all nurture, but never confronted, and they grow up spoiled and entitled, and it happens in church life as well. Or we're nudged and pushed when we feel unwanted. I grew up in a church where it was all legalistic nudge. Nothing's ever good enough. You shouldn't wear that. You shouldn't dress like that. You shouldn't have that music that loud. You shouldn't do those songs. You're not singing the hymns. All I knew was that God didn't really like me. Never realized how much He did love me until I experienced the nurture. And when you experience the nurture, you allow Him to do the nudge. Psalm 139, search me, O God. David, after all he had done wrong, he says, search me, O God, if there's anything in me, in my motives, in my mind, in my manner. If there's anything, go for it. Create in me a clean heart, O God, in another psalm. Why? Because he said, if I go to the bottom of the ocean, you'll be there. My dad used to preach that in the legalistic church. If you sin, God will come looking for you. And if you go to the bottom of the ocean, he'll find you. I thought, whoa, God doesn't love me. I mean, I was 14, and if I looked at a girl the wrong way, whoop, I'm going straight to hell. God's going to judge me. Until I realized that was His love that comes looking for me. If I go to the bottom of the ocean, you'll find me. If I go to the top of the mountain, you knew me before I was even born. When you sit in that chair of knowing His love, then you say, go for it, God. My concern today, and I got sidetracked, which I don't normally do. I was praying, and I felt God say, and I was praying for my son, Michael, who was so broken. And I remember one night I was going to a prayer meeting, and I had to stop the car. I often do this because when I'm alone in the car, I get emotional sometimes. And I said to God, is there anything we can do to make more room for you to come and do your work amongst us? We don't see the miracles we used to see. We don't see what we used to see years ago. And God, Mark chapter 6, you couldn't do much miracles in your town because of people's unbelief. And I knew this wasn't a works program. It wasn't we got to do all these works for God to touch us, but we can prepare atmosphere. We can prepare space. And He gave me five words I want you to write down today, because I believe today, as I was praying this morning at home, at the hotel, God reminded me that this is a word for Europe right now. God is looking for five things because He's going to trust us with a revival of truth. The Word of God's coming back with clarity, not legalism. And these are the five words. Number one, humility. I've already spoken to you about humility today. God is calling us to a posture of humility, not to build our empires. I absolutely am convinced that's why I've joined your family, is that we're not here to build empires, but we're here to humble ourselves, to add value to whatever we can, to see the kingdom established, for Jesus is building his church. Number one is humility. See, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. I'm not saying this, please, please understand my heart. But I love the humility in Pastor Sam's heart, Pastor Bruce's heart, their families. There's never ever been a spirit of competition. I used to hate going to conferences. Everybody's talking about how big what they're doing is and how big, and how does the little guy that's just started off with 10 people feel? See, success is not how big what you do is. Success is obedience. Success is obedience. The second one is hunger. I walked in here last night and I was refreshed. I'm still a bit jet lagged. I'm not well. I've been unwell. I've had pneumonia. And Reason Danny says, gee, I'd like to be in bed right now. Revelation Danny says, I need Jesus more than ever. I'm going to make myself hungry. See, spiritually, sometimes you don't feel hungry. You have to choose to be hungry. And God said to me, there's a new humility coming across the body of Christ. We're not going to see labels. We're going to see a faceless revival that's going to be built by Kingdom Alliance. Humility, hunger. Number three, holiness. And that word scares me because I was taught what holiness was and it wasn't. And so I said to God, Lord, what is holiness? And this is what he put in my head. Anything smarter than I can think of that comes into my head, it's probably God. And it's simply this, a God-given desire to want to please him. Holiness is just a God-given desire. I want to please you, Lord. After all you did for me, in view of what he's done, Romans chapter 12, present your body, not your spirit, not your heart, your body. I said, God, why do we present our bodies? He said, because there needs to be visible sacrifice. And I believe it's a time to come in view of what he's done. You'll never have a problem volunteering if you've had the right view. People burn out all the time in church life because they're serving the church rather than Christ through the church in view of what he's done. Once you've had that revelation, you want to, not have to. So holiness is a desire to want to please him. The next one was honor. He said, it's time to honor the poor, to honor the broken, to honor each other. It's not just about looking after a guest speaker. And we think that's honor, and we do that. But it's honoring each other, honoring the Lord, honoring his word. And the other one was a heart for the broken. I believe if we give ourselves to those five things in commitment to God, we're going to see an authentic move of God that's going to remove churchianity and release Christianity. I grew up in chair number two for the first few years of my life as a churchian. A churchian is a churchgoer. A Christian is a Christ follower. A churchian looks inward. A Christian is outward looking. A churchian has personal outcomes or seeks them. A Christian has purpose outcomes. A churchian is offended easily. Oh, for Jesus, I'm offended. Churchians are easily offended. The divorce rate amongst churches is high. People marry a church, they get offended, they divorce that church. And then they marry another church until they get offended there, because you take you with you wherever you go. And we call it revival. Some people with 50 people end up with 100 because they've come from other churches for the wrong reasons. Church transfer is okay if they come for the right reasons. And so churchians are easily offended. Christians are easily extended. Churchgoers transition. Christ followers transform. Every one of us in this room will go through times of happiness. And then one day there is a trigger point. And you move into a place of being uneasy. Do you know what we do when we feel that? Instead of lifting the hood on what's causing that uneasiness, we transition our external world and try something new. New car, new home. And we feel happy again until there's another trigger point. And then we become uneasy again. And we just keep transitioning and transitioning and transitioning and never transforming. But as Christians, God allows those trigger points, those times of dis-ease, so we can lift the lid and go, what's the problem underneath this? And as we allow God rather than reacting and we respond, some Christians react, some Christians retreat, and they go inward. But if we allow God, search me, O God, like David did, we then transform and we get our happiness back until the next trigger point. The world goes through the same challenges we do as Christians, but we have the blessing of being transformed into his image step by step. I'm so grateful for that today. You see, a churchgoer transitions, but a Christian transforms. A churchgoer or a churchian reacts under pressure. Christians respond under pressure. Churchians can detach when disappointed. But Christians turn disappointment into a God appointment. Now, we don't always get this right. Please understand. But I want to tell you, if we have a revelation of this and allow us to stay in chair number one will give us the revelation to overcome reason. Churchians live by feelings. Christians live by faith. Churchians are very religious with their mouth. Christians are very real with their manner. Churchians seek to be successful. Christians seek to be fruitful. Churchians want to build their image. Christians are conformed to his image. Churchians see the need of others as obstacles. Christians see the needs of others as opportunity. One of the biggest areas of witchcraft in the church is when friends get offended on behalf of their friends. And sometimes people will leave a church because their friend got hurt. And there's been a blind loyalty versus biblical loyalty. And so there's been this all over the Western world where I'm offended. They shouldn't have treated that person like that. And so we're committed to the relationship of friendship. And in those postures, why it's witchcraft, it's manipulation, domination, and intimidation. But God wants Christian unity, which is not blind loyalty, it's biblical loyalty. Christians, I wonder if the musicians can come. Churchians are shaped by the world. But Christians are shaped by the word. And for my life, the thing that's carried me through the loss of a son, the brokenness of a son, disappointed in handing my church over, God's church, over 10 years ago, and watching sadly it go into a direction that wasn't what God planted. And I'm grateful for the power of revelation versus reason. As I'm driving down the road one day and I'm thinking, this is finished. It's gonna go nowhere. My wife and I, in tears, said, why did we give our life to this? We sold up home, we sold up everything to go and plant this church sent by our spiritual father. We saw God, through revelation, build a dream where we renovated hospitals. We worked with kids with cancer. We renovated schools. We saw a community transformed to the point where the prime minister of our nation came to thank our church for the work in the community, and then watch over a period of time all that shut down. It's not about a new thing with a new generation, it's about what God seeded, built through different generations, maybe even different language at times. And I saw what I thought was something we sacrificed our lives. We did it for Jesus. And we were constantly thanking him for the opportunity. Till one day, a moment of revelation. I'm in a mess. God says, ring Sam Monk. Hadn't spoken for ages because of our cancer journey and all the issues we went through. We had not traveled for a while. And as I rang Sam, he said, we don't need to take your churches. We just want to come alongside and help. God opened a door supernaturally out of revelation, out of chair one, that now has taken all our four campuses that only 1 year ago people were saying the doors are going to shut soon. To now, and over the last 2 years, the guys in Bristol pastoring the church with no leaders. Obviously grateful for the leaders that were there on the ground, but no senior pastor, I mean. I had leaders, but no senior pastor. To stand there last Sunday, 460 people in church, worshiping Jesus, pastors in this room, our heads, every pastor and leader and every Christian in this room, our heads are a place of revelation, but they're also the place of accusation. And the same place God gives you revelation is the same place the devil says, you'll never do this. And he will bring accusation. But if you stay in chair number one, the revelation will keep flowing and overcome the accusation. While every head's bowed and every eye closed all over this room, I'm going to hand back in just a moment. There are people, excuse me, all over this room that God has been stirring your heart, but the accuser has been the louder voice. It's like you've been in chair two for too long. And because of the voice of the accuser, you've been thinking of resigning or giving up or saying, I can't do this anymore. And there's a big shift happening right now in the Holy Spirit, right across this room, and God is taking you back to the place of revelation. He's taking you back to the place where his voice is going to speak louder than any other. God is repositioning. I was praying this morning. He said, I'm recalibrating and I'm resetting and putting people back on course that have sort of lost their course along the way because of discouragement. You've been under personal attack from people around you, people that you love, and you've retreated, and you're allowing reason to take over your thinking rather than revelation. And if that's you, I'd like you to slip up your hand. I just want to pray for you this morning. Wow, 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 wow. 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 Can we all stand to our feet right now? And you know, I believe there's such a spirit of family in this place. Again, I'm not surprised we don't stick to our notes, because the Holy Spirit's not interested in my articulation. He's interested in your impartation. And this morning in this place, we're going to start worshiping. And I feel that there's so much love in this movement. I want you just to pray for one another for a minute. And pray for revelation to come back. Pray for the accusation to go. We all have it. Pray that we can all go back to chair number one. And that we don't live in that place of feeling provided for but not nurtured. Some of you have not felt the nurture of God for a long time. And right now the Holy Spirit's going to come with, around those that pray for you. And you're going to feel the nurture of heaven. I release this place right now to start praying for one another as we worship the Lord.
To do whatever you want, I will make room, I will make room for you. To do whatever you want, to do whatever you want, and I will make room.
Time is gone, but I believe we've only got one more day together. Just felt the Holy Spirit say, I'm releasing the spirit of prophecy over this conference, where don't wait for a meeting, but as you're having lunch together, as you're having life together, Father, I pray in the next 24 hours for divine appointments. People with one another having divine appointments. And that the word of the Lord will come for all those that have been going through, listen to this carefully, You've been going through a slowly. And there's a suddenly coming. There's a suddenly coming. There's a one day. Moses in the back end of the desert is doing his every day, just being faithful. And then there's a one day. And there's a suddenly. I was praying this morning. The Lord said, there's many people that are tired. You feel like you've been going along, just doing it out of obedience. But your suddenly and your one day is going to be released, this conference. I believe it. So, Father, I release the spirit of prophecy that encourages people with a suddenly and a word from God. And may miracles happen out of this conference beyond what is shared from the platform, as good as that is. And Father, I release that over this time together in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.
We sing, shake up the ground. So shake up the ground of all my tradition.
Just before we go to lunch, let's sing it out.
To do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. I will make room for you. To do whatever you want.
Come on, can we thank Jesus in this place? Can we put our hands together for Pastor Danny as well? Alfredo. What a great man he is. And don't you love the spirit, the heart? I believe there's so much in there that we can take from this place and just outwork it. Every church represented. I just believe this environment is going to be impacting in a way that's going to take your church, your ministry, to a whole nother level. How many feel that in this place? Come on, just represent right around. Yeah, God's doing a great work. Well, we've got lunch coming up. 2 o'clock, we've got the Wild. 2:30 in here, we've got a leadership session. But right now, enjoy some friendship, some connection, and some food. And let's have lunch back in here. 2:30, a leadership elective. And then also the Wild starting at 2 p.m. I think all the details will come up on screen. But we'll see you back here. 7:30 tonight as well. Going to be a powerful time if you're from London. Put the message out. I think we do have a few spare seats around that you can get people to come out and be a part of. Well, it's going to be an incredible time. God bless. Enjoy your lunch.